Hi, my name is Holly Pike. I am the owner of Artistic Threadworks. I'm also a digitizer. I create embroidery designs. I still remember how many questions I had when I started in the machine embroidery hobby. It looked really easy in the store, but when I got home, I couldn't remember half the things my dealer showed me. I now own www.artisticthreadworks.com. It is the largest embroidery community on the internet. Some of the most often asked questions in our discussion forum are about getting started. So this video was created to help the newcomers get off to a flying start. I'd like to start by showing you some of the things you can do with your new embroidery machine. This is called a trunk show. These projects have been created and sent to us by our members from around the world. After the trunk show, I will show you the secrets to mastering the basics of machine embroidery. I'm just going to run through these quickly so that you can get an idea of the types of things you can do. Check out our photo gallery on ArtisticThreadWorks.com for 3,000 more ideas. Here's a pot holder. Someone took a pot holder and just embroidered it and put some fabric on the back. A picture frame. A little fanny pack type item that has been embroidered. A baby blanket. A kitchen towel. This one's rather clever. This is a wreath, and all of these little guys are embroidered gingerbreads and stuffed and placed on the wreath for the holidays. A roll of paper towels. There's a technique for this, and this is on our website in the discussion forum. You can search on embroidering on toilet paper, and you'll find the technique for doing that. A cute little kitty bag that has been assembled after it has been embroidered. A messenger bag embroidered with number one nurse. This is a pre-made item, so they just took this item and then embroidered on the top. And a very, very clever item. This is a box that has been embroidered. They embroidered on balsa wood and then attached that to the top of the box for a little storage. That's just a little trunk show. There are lots more ideas in our photo gallery. Let's move on to the nine elements of good machine embroidery. Number one, a machine in good working order. If you think that you may have a problem with your machine, be sure to get into your dealer and see your repair technician. Number two, a good design. I like to start with the built-in designs because they're always good. Three, good quality embroidery thread. There are many brands out there, but just to name a few, Sulky, Madeira, Robeson Anton, Coates, Pace Setter, which is Brothers thread, Fufu, and many others. You'll also need bobbin thread. Four, a good needle. Five, the right stabilizers. Six, properly prepared fabric. Seven, good hooping technique. Eight, snips for cutting the jump stitches. And nine, tweezers. Let's start with your machine and what comes with it. First, you'll have a hoop, or possibly two hoops or three hoops, depending on your machine. You'll have some hoop grids that go inside your hoop, and we'll talk about what these are for later. You may have received a screwdriver or two. My recommendation at this point would be just put those in a drawer and let's not worry about them. Let the technician take care of anything that needs to be taken apart. You may have received some oil. This oil is for my Baby Lock EMP6. That machine does require oiling every 8 hours of use. If your machine did not come with oil, that's a clue. That's a clue that you shouldn't be oiling it. Let your technician take care of your 6 month and your 1 year repair time, and they'll oil and lubricate everything that needs to be done. Your dealer is a great resource for you. If you have a local dealer, be very, very thankful. Many people drive hours just to pick up thread or to have their technician look at their sewing machine if they have a problem. Your dealer understands a lot of things about you and your machine and the embroidery hobby. He understands the machines that they sell, he understands what you need to be successful, and he understands what your machine needs to continue to work properly. If your dealer offers classes, take them. Here are some basics of machine care. Get to know your repair technician. You should know him or her on a first name basis. Become friendly with them. Understand how to talk to them. When should you take your machine in is a common question I see all the time. I suggest annually or every 6 months, depending on how often you use your machine. If you use them as often as I do, then every 6 months is really unnecessary. Your machine will tell you when it needs repair. It will begin to act in a peculiar way. You'll notice, and then you'll take it in. Ask your dealer and your repair technician how to keep your machine clean. There are many machines and many different ways of keeping them clean. Talk to them. Find the right way so that you'll avoid the problems in the future. If you do receive error messages on your machines, all of them are computerized now and we all get messages, please copy them down completely, word for word, and don't forget those little letters at the bottom of the screen. Let's cover safety next. Safety is very important in my studio with the people that work with me. We need to be very careful of our hands. Without our hands, it's very difficult to enjoy our hobby. So when the machine is running, never ever place your hands in any area of the hoop while the machine is running. Never in any area of the hoop. You never know what can happen, and it's just not worth the chance. How about your children and your machines? If you have small children, you need to train your children that they never should touch the machine ever, even when it's not running. Accidents happen, and I've heard stories of children getting their fingers sewn by the needle or stuck in the needle if the presser foot drops when the machine isn't running. So please keep your children away from your machine and explain to them that when they're older, you'll show them how to use the machine. It's always wise to wear eye protection. We do in my studio. And anyone that works with me uses eye protection. Needles can break away and fly in any direction, and we just don't want a problem. So wear your eye protection. Tension settings. Another good question I get all the time is, what does a well-done design look like? Well, I have a sample here for you that I can show you that I did on my Elegante. And it's a built-in design. And you can see on this design that the satin stitching is very uniformed and very neat and very clean. Sometimes you'll see white bobbin thread coming up on the edges of your satin stitch. That's telling you that there's a tension problem. On the back of the design, you'll see just about an equal amount of white bobbin thread to top color thread. You'll see top color thread on both sides of the satin stitch and white bobbin thread in the middle. That's correct. That's a good sewing tension. If it's different, if you see all top color, you have a tension problem and it needs to be addressed. Another sample of good tension would be from my EMP6. And this is a design built into the machine that we stitch. And as you can see on this design, there's about 1/3 top color, 1/3 bobbin thread, and 1/3 top color. That's correct. You should see bobbin thread on the bottom. Okay, so we know we should see bobbin thread on the bottom, but we shouldn't see bobbin thread on the top. If you do, again, that's a tension problem. You need to take your machine in and learn about the tension. If you have looping of the thread on the top or looping on the bottom, again, that is a bobbin tension or a top tension problem. Tension adjustments differ from one model to the next. So, see your dealer to learn how to adjust your machine's tension and how to keep it adjusted. Now that your machine is working right, you'll need a good design. What do I mean by a good design? Not all designs are created equal. When a design sews out poorly, it could be a problem with your machine, a problem with your technique, or a poor quality design. You need to understand which problem you have when you see these occur. If the problem is caused by your machine, it will happen on every design or almost every one. Use a built-in design to test your machine. Use the same one all the time. Have one design that you sew out as your test design so you can see if your machine has changed. If you suspect a problem, sew out that design, compare it to the last sew out. See your dealer if the built-in designs don't sew out right. Whenever you pick up your machine after servicing, ask the technician, "What was the problem?" so I can avoid it in the future. They will be more than happy to talk with you about keeping your machine in top running condition. If a problem is caused by your technique, it will happen at random. These are a little tougher to find. Sometimes a design will sew out fine, and other times the same design will sew out badly. Or it will sew out right on one material, but the same design will sew out wrong on a different material. Hopefully, by the time you finish watching this video, you will know how to avoid those technique problems. If you are still having problems, ask others how they manage to get certain types of embroidery to come out. The Artistic ThreadWorks discussion forum is a great place for help like that. If the design is bad, it'll sew out poorly all the time. Check other designs by the same digitizer and see if it's a common problem with that digitizer's designs. Sew out your test designs to verify that it isn't your machine. Then contact the digitizer for help with the design. A good digitizer will want to hear from you if there's a problem. What about getting quality designs? There are several big name companies that have been making designs for many, many years. They have many digitizers on staff all the time. Some of them would be Amazing Designs, Cactus Punch, Dakota Collectibles, Brother. A lot of other major manufacturers have design cards for you. These companies invest thousands of dollars into creating quality designs every day, all day. I've never seen one of their designs sew out with a problem, so you're always safe with those. Your dealer probably stocks designs from the big companies and may also stock from smaller businesses too. There are also hundreds of small businesses that make designs and sell them in stores around the web. Look for sample or free designs from these digitizers and try sewing them out. If you like the quality of their digitizing, then stick with that digitizer's designs. Also, you can ask other people in our discussion forum if they have had good luck with designs from a particular digitizer. How are designs created? This is a big question. Designs are created through a process called digitizing. Digitizing starts with artwork, then the artwork is digitized or traced and drawn with special software, and electronically the stitches are put into the artwork. Digitizing is not a conversion like changing a JPEG to a GIF file. It takes special software, time to master the software, and talent. Digitizing is a skill, similar to playing an instrument. Just as buying a piano doesn't make one a concert pianist, buying the software to digitize is only a starting point for creating embroidery designs. If you're interested in learning to digitize, start by asking others that you admire how they got started. Design formats. What is a format? This seems to puzzle many. Different machines require designs that you put them into to be different machine languages. Language is known as a format. All you need to know is which format your machine requires. Ask your dealer this question. Most machines require designs in their format only. You can convert designs from one format to another format with software. Ask your dealer what software they offer for converting designs. BuzzTools is very popular and not very expensive. You can see some videos about using different conversion programs on our resource page at www.basicsofembroidery.com. The TXT or text files are very important. They hold your color and stitch information. Don't delete these. Keep these with your designs. You'll need them. PES is the most common format and is used by Brother and Baby Lock, as well as some Bernina and Elna machines. DST is used in commercial machines. HUS is used by Husqvarna. So and Jeff are used by Janome. Art is used by Bernina Artista machines. XXX and PSW are used by Singer machines. But how do I get designs into my machine? That's a great question. We hear it all the time. Built-in designs are no problem. Just bring it up on the screen and you're good to go. Pre-programmed cards, like this one from Baby Lock, are again no problem. You insert it into your machine, bring it up on the screen, and you're good to go. Well, those are all easy, but how do I work with designs on CD, like these? Or with internet designs? Well, there's a solution. It's called design transfer boxes. There are several boxes available depending on your embroidery machine, and they all work similarly. Your machine manufacturer probably makes a box. Ask your dealer what they recommend. The PE Design Palette box looks like this. The Amazing Box, Magic Box, and Ultimate Box all look similar to this. See our resource page for software demo on these types of boxes at www.basicsofembroidery.com. Okay, now it's time to get serious. We need to talk about copyrights. There are a lot of questions out there about copyrights, what is right and what is wrong, and I'm going to try and help you with that. Artwork is copyrighted by the creator. Copyright laws provide for severe penalties, both civil and criminal, for violators. A design that has been illegally copied from another digitizer or has been created using artwork that digitizers do not have the rights to is called pirated or stolen. How do I find legal embroidery designs? Well, you have your built-in designs. They are 100% legal. Then you have dealers. You go to your dealer. They stock lots of designs, and your dealer couldn't possibly ever sell a pirated design. They just have too much to lose to do that. It's a safe place to buy. Internet sales. There are some sites that are good and some sites that are bad, just like everything else. But you need to learn how to tell which is which. A quick guide to spotting pirated designs. If you see Disney, Looney Tunes, Warner Brothers, Hello Kitty, Thomas the Train, NASCAR, Ford, Coca-Cola, Harley Davidson, or any other name brand or trademark design being sold by anyone other than one of the big design companies, odds are it has been stolen. All this artwork belongs to someone and are only licensed to a digitizer or company that is willing to pay a large licensing fee. 1,000 Disney designs for $5 is not legitimate. Just don't buy it. More ways to spot pirated designs? An auction site on the internet. On a typical day, 75% of the sales are for pirated or stolen designs. If you can't tell which 3 out of 4 are pirated designs, then don't buy there. I never buy designs from an auction site on the internet. It's not safe. Don't do it. You may see that there is no address for the seller, no one to contact if you have a problem. The seller may be in a country that looks the other way at piracy, like Russia or China or some other countries. Additional problems with pirated designs would be many buyers don't receive anything, or you receive a blank disc, or you receive a disc with badly digitized designs. What if you've already bought pirated designs? Well, my advice would be don't use them. You may be sued by the copyright owners. You would be supporting a criminal enterprise. You would be breaking the law. Besides, would you want those type of people to have access to your credit card number? I wouldn't. Avoid getting yourself into legal trouble. When you buy a disc with designs on it, you become the owner of the disc and a licensee of the designs. You're buying a license to use those designs in the manner that the license specifies. The license never says you can resell designs or share them. You may or may not be allowed to sell products with designs sewn onto them. Check the user license agreement. Free designs. You'll see free designs on the internet. They are samples for you to try out a digitizer's abilities. Free designs still belong to the digitizer. You may not share them. Downloading a free design does not give you the right to redistribute it. If another person wants the design, give them the website and let them get it themselves. Machine manufacturers and the large design companies also have websites where they offer sample designs. Check our resource page for links to all of those sites, www.basicsofembroidery.com. Copyrights can be confusing. It's a very good idea to belong to an online discussion forum where you can ask others questions, like, have you ever bought from Fancy That Designs? And are the designs good? Did you get your stuff? Okay, now that we're done with the serious stuff, let's move on to the shameless plug. My website, ArtisticThreadWorks.com. We have a wonderful discussion forum with the experience of thousands of others to draw from. Over 50,000 posts where you can search and find answers to any question you could possibly have. Thousands of legitimate designs you can download and use. How-to videos that are online. A getting started section. A photo gallery for inspiration. Over 3,000 photos for you to browse through and get inspiration for your hobby. Articles for the embroidery business owner, and lots more. Our resource page at www.basicsofembroidery.com has information about getting designs from your PC to your embroidery machine, using format conversion software, using software to back up your designs, and how to get onto our weekly freebies list. Another question I hear all the time is, can I use regular sewing thread for embroidery? Well, it's a simple answer, no. And I'll tell you why. The weight is different, the texture is different, it just won't work. So just don't do it. Use embroidery thread. There are three or four different types of embroidery thread. Rayon, polyester, metallic, multicolored, and there's a new twisted color on the market. Which should I use, I hear? Well, let's talk about the different kinds. This is rayon. Now, you won't see a big difference on the screen, but I can tell you that rayon has a beautiful sheen to it, and it usually comes in many more colors by most of the manufacturers. Polyester would be the next one, and though now they're coming in many, many colors, the sheen isn't quite as bright. But the benefits of polyester are you can use this on baby clothing because it's bleach resistant. It washes very well and it holds up very, very well over the long term. So this is a great thread. Metallic thread, as you can see, it's more shiny and it has a metallic feel to it. This is wonderful for decorating and for just highlighting things in your embroidery. Then we have the twisted tweed. This happens to be a Robeson Anton brand, but I believe there are other brands on the market by some companies. Basically, what they've done is they've taken two colors and twisted them together to get the same weight as embroidery thread, but it gives really pretty, almost a two-dimensional look to your embroidery. Try it. I think you'll like it. And then the standard variegated. This is three or four colors in the same color family. In this case, it's red, white, and blue for the holidays. So you would have white, and then it would blend into red, and then it would blend into blue, and then it would blend back to white. You can get some very interesting effects with variegated thread on some of your designs. Your dealer stocks the right thread for your machine. If you're using metallic threads, a word of advice. If you can slow your machine down, slow it down, even down to 300 stitches per minute. It'll take a little longer, but it'll break less and you'll have much nicer results. Also, use a metallic needle. It has a larger eye and it causes less friction with that thread going through it, so it'll break less. Bobbins. Bobbins are very important. You can wind your own bobbins like we've been doing for years and years as sewers, or you can buy pre-wound bobbins. You need to ask your dealer what is best for your machine. If your dealer tells you that pre-wound bobbins are okay, then there are several types of pre-wound bobbins that you can use. This bobbin is a cardboard bobbin. It has cardboard sides and a core in the center. Works well, there's nothing wrong with it. This bobbin is a plastic bobbin. It's plastic core, plastic sides, works well, nothing wrong with it. I prefer the plastic because it leaves less residue in my bobbin casing and there's less cleaning to do. Your dealer will tell you the best choice for your machine. For certain types of embroidery, you may want to use the same color thread in your bobbin as on your top designs. That would be any time that the back of your design is going to show and you want it to look just as beautiful as the top part of your design. So if you're doing lace, make a bobbin with the same color thread and you'll be amazed at how beautiful the result really is. The right needle for your machine. You need to check with your dealer or with your manual and make sure you have the right needle and the right size for your machine. Your dealer carries top quality needles. Buy them in bulk. They're not very expensive and you will need a lot of them. There are four types of needles that I'm going to talk about today, and that is your ballpoint needle. Your ballpoint needle is used for knits or lightly woven fabrics. It passes between the fibers instead of splitting the fibers. So if you're doing a knit polo shirt, you may want to use a ballpoint needle. Then we have our sharp needles. This happens to be an Oregon brand. We have our sharps. This is used for most every other embroidery project out there. We have metallic needles, and they say metallic right on the case so that you know you're getting metallic needles. And these are used whenever you're doing a large area of metallic. The needle is larger and it passes through the fabric a little easier with that metallic thread, causing less friction and less breakage of your thread. The last needle I'm going to talk about is a titanium needle. This needle is very similar to the sharp or the ballpoint. It's made out of the same material, except it's coated in titanium. It causes this to go through the fabric a little smoother. They're a little stronger, so they may last just a little bit longer for you. When should I replace my needle? Well, certainly if it's bent, you should replace it. If it's dull, you should replace it. But how do I know when it's dull? Well, some people replace their needles after so many sewing hours, like 8 sewing hours they put a new needle in, or before you start a new project. I have a friend that every time she starts a new project, she puts a fresh needle in her sewing machine. That way she knows she's got a good needle for her project. I do it by sound. I listen to my machines. They're right around me when I'm working during the day, and I can hear when the needle changes, when the sound changes. It'll kind of pop through your fabric instead of slipping through your fabric. And then I know, okay, my machine wants a new needle, so it's time to replace it. What is stabilizer and why do I need it? Stabilizer is a backing that we put behind our fabric or garment to help stabilize that fabric or garment while sewing. It helps the fabric to not stretch or move when you're embroidering. My favorite is tearaway. Tearaway is called that just because you can tear it. It's very easy. It pulls clean around the edges of your designs and it adds a very nice soft backing for your embroidery. Another product is tearaway wash away. It is the same as tearaway. It's great on baby things or towels because once you launder it, it washes away the remaining stabilizer that may be left once you tore it away. It's a really nice product. cutaway. Cutaway is just that. It's stabilizer that is a little thicker, but you cut it away from the design. You'll embroider the design and then cut away and leave about a quarter to a half inch around the design to continue to stabilize that design after it's laundered on a softer fabric. An iron-on stabilizer, which is again one of my favorites, this one is made by Sulky, and it has a waxy back and a paper side. You lay it down on the waxy side on the back of your fabric and iron it with a hot iron. And then it helps your knits to not stretch. Once you iron this on, it just simply won't allow stretching and it won't allow movement of your fabric. So it ensures a much better product when you're finished. Sticky stabilizer is a great product. It's a fun product. You can use this when you have something that you can't hoop. Basically, you hoop this stabilizer in your hoop, and then you take a pin and just score it and peel off the stabilizer. Then you can place your item, whatever it is, if it's something that's velvet or that you don't want a hoop mark, you can place your item on top of that, and that will hold it in place so that you can embroider. It's a great product, and it's fun to use. I never recommend taking your sticky stabilizer, peeling it, and sticking it on the bottom of your hoop. Your hoop will get all sticky and all gooey, and then you have another project to clean it. We also have a product called Wet and Set. I like this product because it's water activated. With this, it's a little stiffer, and you would hoop this and then spray a very light mist of water. Place your fabric or your garment on top of it, and it'll hold it in place. One thing I really like about this stabilizer is the more water you use, the more it sticks. The less you use, the less it sticks. So if it's something a little more delicate, you can use less water and not have a problem getting it off the stabilizer. Another type of stabilizer is a water-soluble stabilizer. But keep in mind that though it's called a stabilizer, it really isn't a stabilizer. It's more of a topper. It's a product that you put on top of your fabric or garment to embroider on top of, which gives you a clean surface. You would use this for fleece or anything with a nap on it, like velvet or velveteen or corduroy or something like that, or a towel. It holds the loops down on the towel so you have a smooth stitching surface. Then it tears away very nicely, and when you launder it, it goes away. So it's clear and very thin. So this is really a topper. It's not a stabilizer. The other type is a product called Wet and Gone from Floriani. This looks like fabric, but it's thinner. It's kind of woven. And this you hoop in your hoop, and you can sew things like lace on here, or you could use it as a topper on baby items, because once you immerse it in water, it goes away. Another technique that I use from time to time is called floating. Floating is really very simple. When you have your hoop hooped up with your fabric and your stabilizer, you may at times need just a little extra stabilization to make that design sew out well. And you may not know it until you start sewing, and then you look at it and say, I maybe like another little piece of tearaway in there. So then what you do is you would stop your machine and cut your thread. Then take your stabilizer and slide it underneath the hoop like this. Now it's just going to sit there and move with your embroidery machine and with your arm while you stitch and provide that extra little bit of stabilization. For Christmas ornaments or pot holders or anything where I'd like the back to look just as nice as the front, but I don't want them to see the embroidery. What I do is I embroider my item, and then just at the end, I take the fabric and turn it right side down against the machine, slide it under the hoop, and finish up my outline or my border or whatever is the last step on my embroidery project. What about preparing the fabric? If I'm doing a quilt or a wall hanging or something that I'm going to use fabric and sew into a project, I certainly will wash the fabric to remove the sizing. Then, while it's damp, I'll spray it with spray starch. Then, when it's dry, I'll iron it, but I'll use a little water spray, spray it lightly, iron it to get all the wrinkles out, and then spray it with starch again and iron again. If I'm using a garment and I'm giving the garment as a gift, it's kind of tough to wash the gift first. So you may not want to wash a gift. But if it's a garment for your own use, I would highly recommend washing the garment first so that it shrinks. Then apply your stabilizer and do your embroidery. Let's do a demo of preparing a t-shirt type garment using iron-on. I've already put my iron-on stabilizer onto my garment. I turned it inside out, laid the waxy side down, and used a medium hot iron to get the stabilizer to stick. So that's on. I'll lay my shirt down, slide my bottom hoop inside. Now I'm not going to worry about placement right now. I'm just showing you the steps to hooping a t-shirt so that your project will come out great. I'll put my hoop underneath the stabilizer. Then I'll take the Solvi, the topper that we talked about, and put that on top. Now, even though the t-shirt doesn't have a nap to it, we don't want hoop marks on our t-shirt when we unhoop it. So to eliminate some of that, I put my topper on the top. Now I'll hoop everything together, push it in there, and we're ready to sew on our t-shirt. Hooping is very important. I think hooping is probably one of the most important techniques that you really need to understand. The reason I think this is because the hoop is the first thing and the last thing that touches your project or your fabric. So let's talk about how to hoop and how to hoop perfectly every time. I take my bottom hoop and I loosen it so that it's very loose. Lay the bottom hoop down. Place your stabilizer on top. Then I'm going to use just a piece of felt for demonstration purposes. Lay this down on top. Smooth it out so everything looks nice and smooth. Take the part of the hoop that's furthest away from you and push it down into the bottom hoop. And just hold it there. Now you can smooth anything out that you need to smooth out. Holding it with just two fingers, I now take the butts of my hand and push it down into the hoop. And what you get is a nice, smooth, very flat surface for embroidery. Now, because we had it so loose, the top hoop went in very easily. Now, I'll take the screw and I'll tighten it down until it's good and snug. With my fingers only. Never, ever use a screwdriver. There's never a need to use a screwdriver for hooping. Tighten it down as far as you can, comfortably with your fingers. Push the hoop down in. Now back that screw off about a half a turn. Now your hoop is set for this type of fabric. If you want to do 10 shirts or 10 towels or 100 of something, you can do that. You can set your hoop, and every time all you have to do is lay your stabilizer down, your fabric or your garment on top, and hoop your project. Let me show you this again now that the hoop is set. Here's my hoop. I'll lay my stabilizer down, and then I'll lay my fabric down on top of that. I'll smooth everything out. Place the top end of my hoop, the furthest part away from me, into the top end of the bottom hoop. Straighten everything. Hold the hoop with a couple of fingers, and with the butts of my hand, I'm going to push that hoop down into place. Now you see how easy that was. The hoop is set and it's ready to go. You will get 100% hooping every time with this method. There's never a need ever to pull at your fabric or at your stabilizer. Don't do that. If you do that, your designs will not sew out correctly, they won't line up, your outlines won't match up. Okay, how about that myth about if I can't hoop it, I can't embroider it? Well, let's talk about that. I'm going to take my sulky stinky stabilizer. I'm going to lay it on my bottom hoop, and I'm going to hoop this just as I would a fabric. Now that's in there, I'm going to take my tweezers, something with a sharp point, and I'm just going to gently score around the outside edge here. Pick up the edge and just peel it off. This is going to give us a nice sticky surface to apply our item that is difficult to hoop. And what I'm going to show you is something that we all like to do, and that's napkins. I'm going to take my napkin, and notice if you want to do the corner of a napkin, it's kind of tough to hoop it. So I'm going to lay this down on my sticky stabilizer, and I'm just going to press it down. Now you can put this on the machine, and you can embroider that corner without having to hoop it. And there you go. Before going on to hooping our towel and showing you how to use the topper and a stabilizer, I'd like to talk to you about a product called Sewer's Aid. This is a great product. If you use a lot of the sticky stabilizer that we just talked about, or the wet and gone, you may want to use Sewer's Aid. You can get this at Joanne Fabrics in the Notions department. It's about $12 a bottle. Seems expensive, but use a Q-tip, put a drop on the Q-tip, and just rub that onto your needle. This allows the needle to pass through that sticky stabilizer without it getting all gummy and gooey and breaking threads. It's a great product. Okay, let's talk about hooping a towel. We all like to give fingertip towels at the holiday time, so let me show you a good way to do it so that you'll get a great result every time. Let's lay our bottom hoop down, place our tearaway wash away down. Now I use the tearaway wash away because that's going to wash away any remaining stabilizer that's left once we launder this. Lay our towel down on the top. Make sure everything's fitting in the hoop. Again, I'm not talking about placement here. I'm talking about the order that we hoop things using the stabilizers and the toppers. Line it up the way you like it. Take your sulky salvy, lay it down, smooth it out. Now take your top hoop, and we're going to hoop them all together. I'm going to straighten everything before I push the hoop in. Never tug on your fabric once it's hooped, but it's okay to adjust it now. And then I'm just going to push that down into the hoop, and you're ready to go. I'm always asked, what type of scissors do I use to cut jump stitches? Well, I like these little embroidery snips. They're squeeze handles and they're curved and they clip very nicely and very clean. When cutting jump stitches, it's best to snip them after each color. I do this because it's kind of tough to get in and clip a jump stitch underneath other sewing. And it's just the worst thing when you have blue thread underneath white thread and it's a jump stitch and you forgot to cut it. So it's best to do it between colors. And this is how I handle my jump stitches. I'm going to use this piece of fabric and design. It's not the best, but you'll get the idea. I use my tweezers, and these are Tweezerman tweezers. I get them at Walgreens. They're about $12, so it seems expensive, but they have very, very nice tips. They grip every time. They're easy to use, and you'll never have to buy another pair. So go ahead and make that investment in your embroidery hobby. When I clip a jump stitch or a thread, I'll take the tweezers and take my thread and pull it up snug. I'll pull it up real snug, and I'll put my scissors down at the base of that thread, and while pulling up, I'll cut that stitch. That gives you a nice clean area underneath that stitch that you cut. Here's another one. I'll pull it up nice and snug. I'll push my scissors down and I'll cut that stitch while I'm pulling on it. You'll never see a jump stitch, a little tail or anything, if you'll cut your jump stitches that way. Okay, how about those grids that came with your hoops? These little grids are used for lining up your embroidery in your hoop so that hopefully your design is centered. They're very easy to use. Let's look at the hoop first, and let me show you something about your hoops. On your hoop, the top hoop that inserts into the bottom hoop, there will probably be some little raised areas on all four sides of your hoop. This is to help you line up and to hold your grids when you're using your grids to line your design up. If you don't have these marks, then you probably want to measure your hoops and put a permanent mark with a permanent marker on there so you know exactly where the center of your long sides are and where your short sides are. Let's mark our fabric for the center so that we can learn how to use our grid to center our fabric in the hoop. I'm going to use my disappearing ink marker, and this is a great marker. It just disappears with the humidity in the air, so there's no washing it out or anything like that. Let's mark our fabric. I'm going to lay my grid down, and I'm going to put a mark in the center. You can use any marking system you like for this, but it's best to have top, bottom, and the sides marked so that you can grid this and get it centered. All right, we'll take our bottom hoop, lay our stabilizer down, and then lay our project down on the hoop. And you can pretty much see if you're close to being centered in the hoop. I'll take my top hoop and just lay it on the top like that. I'll put my grid in, and now I can see whether I'm lined up. And this is showing me that I'm not lined up. My center hole is here and my center mark is there. Now I can just move my fabric to where I need it to be. To line up the center. I can lift my hoop, take my grid out, put the top part of the hoop into the top part of the bottom hoop, hold it down with the butts of your hand, just press it in. Your design will now be centered and will look the way it's supposed to look in the hoop. The Embroidery Buddy is a great tool for design placement on shirts. It's made by ABC Embroidery Systems, and you can find them on the internet. And they're a really great company to do business with. This is one of them. It's for the youth sizes, and this is for the adult sizes. They have a new one out that goes all the way from extra small up to triple X for adults. So they now have three, which is very exciting. I'm going to show you using a child's sweatshirt, how to use the Embroidery Buddy. It's really very simple. Let's lay our sweatshirt down, smooth everything out. This is a 2X, so it's just for a little guy. Smooth everything out. On the Embroidery Buddy, you can see that there's a marking for child 2 on this side and a marking for child 2 on this side. What we want to do is we want to put this arrow right up where the shoulder meets the neck collar, just like that. That should put this other marking in the center of the shirt. If you're not sure where this is, if it's a raglan sleeve or an unusually shaped item, go for the center of your shirt. Measure and find your center and put the child 2 in the center, then you'll be able to line this one up with the shoulder for design placement. Now that we have that, I'll take my disappearing marker and I'll put a mark on the shirt where I want the center of that design to be. At this point, I'll take my embroidery grid, lay this down, and I will mark top, bottom, left, and right. Now we're ready to hoop this shirt. You can get a design placement guide on our resource page at www.basicsofembroidery.com. It'll have some helpful tips on where to place a design on various items. Let's move on to test sewing. I'm often asked, why do I have to test sew? How do I test sew? And boy, don't you think that's a waste of time? Well, let me answer those questions for you. You should test sew because you never know how a design will respond and react on a fabric. Many digitizers test sew on one type of fabric. It's difficult as a digitizer to take into account all the many fabrics and all the many stabilizers that are out there for you to use. So, even with designs that you fully trust, I always recommend that you test sew. How do you test sew? Well, you simply take a piece of fabric and stabilizer that are going to replicate exactly what you're going to be doing with your fabric and your project, for your finished project. You hoop that up and you test sew your design. If it sews out great, you're in business. If it doesn't, then you may need to make some adjustments. You may need to add stabilizer, remove stabilizer. You may need to add iron-on stabilizer. So it's very important. Test sewing is not a waste of time. If you do your test sewing creatively, you can use your test sews later for rag quilts or pillows or framed gifts or lots of things. So think about, how can I use this test sew once it's done and it's sewed out perfect? How can I use this later so that I don't feel like I'm wasting my supplies? Whether you think you're going to make a mistake or not, it has been my experience that it's not a question of if, but when. So let's talk about how to try and salvage some of those items that maybe you've made a mistake and you need to take that embroidery out and start all over again. It happens to us all. My favorite tool for this is Peggy's Stitch Eraser. It looks like a little razor, a little shaver, and that's exactly what it is. Only we're going to use it for stitches instead of for a guy's beard. Here's how we use the Peggy Stitch Eraser. Take your embroidery out of the hoop. You need to do that. Turn it over. Leave the stabilizer on, because that will protect your fabric or your garment. Let's turn our Stitch Eraser on, and then we're just simply going to work our way down the design and remove as much of the back of the stitches as we possibly can, trying to go carefully. Just remove the backs of the stitches. Once you've done that, let me get my tweezers. Now you can turn it around to the correct side and take your good tweezerman tweezers, and you can now just start pulling those stitches right out of the fabric very, very easily. And you can do this and remove designs completely and still salvage your garment and not waste that money on that project that you purchased. Take your time, go slow, you'll be fine. Let's review a few things about the tension and your machine. When you see bobbin thread showing on the top of a design, that would mean you have your color that's stitching very nicely, then all of a sudden you see that bobbin thread creeping up on the sides of your stitching. That tells you that you now have a tension problem. Something that you can do is you can stop and change the bobbin. My theory is all bobbins were not meant to be bobbins. So just don't worry about the cost of a bobbin. They're very inexpensive. Change the bobbin. See if that fixes your problem. You may at some time see your top thread wrapping around to the bottom so that your bobbin thread doesn't show at all. That's a tension issue. Again, you can try changing your bobbin. You can try changing your needle. Sometimes these things help. If they don't help, then you need to go to your dealer, go to your friendly repair technician, and get some help. Another thing you may run into are what we call thread nests. This is when you're sewing along and your machine, for some reason, doesn't pick up the bobbin thread, but it keeps sewing and it creates a nest underneath your embroidery. It's not very pleasant. The only thing that you can do at this point is stop your machine. I recommend then turning it off. Take your snips, lift the hoop a little bit, get your snips in and clip those threads. Remove your hoop and then pull those threads with your tweezers out from the workings of the machine, out from where the feed dogs are on the machine. Get as much out as you can and then give it another try. If it still doesn't sew well, you may have some bobbin thread caught in there. As a beginner, I do not recommend removing any part of your machine for any reason. Go to your dealer, ask your dealer to help you if you need a tension adjustment. They'll be happy to help. Inches to millimeters, millimeters to inches. I've seen more people afraid of using the millimeter measurement in embroidery than anywhere else. It's easy to convert your inches to millimeters or your millimeters to inches. Basically, 25 millimeters is just about an inch. So that makes it easy. 25 millimeters equals 1 inch, 50 millimeters equals 2 inches, 75 millimeters equals 3 inches, and 100 millimeters equals 4 inches. I want you to see our resource page, and you'll find lots of information there, and that's at www.basicsofembroidery.com. We're going to ask you to register ownership of this video. Then you'll be given access to design placement guide, videos on using software for conversion and other things, free replacement of the video disc should anything happen to it, and free sample designs. I hope you've enjoyed this video as much as I've enjoyed making it. I hope that it makes your journey from beginner to advanced embroiderer much faster and much more fun. Join us at www.artisticthreadworks.com, where we say the embroidery community meets to unravel. Thanks for watching.